impetus for this paper was a case that we filed an amicus briefing called Franchise Tax Board versus Hyatt. And in that case, it was filed by a Nevada citizen in a Nevada state court against what the party described as an arm of the state of California. And California said, this violates the Constitution. We have a constitutional right of sovereign immunity. And the Supreme Court said, sure, why not? This bothered us for two reasons. First of all, there is no particular clause of the Constitution that limits what a state can do to another state in its courts. That's not what the 11th Amendment says. That's not what anything else in the Constitution says. And secondly, it seemed like the Supreme Court's hearing the appeal was barred by the 11th Amendment, because here you have a suit by a citizen of a different state against a state of California, and that's supposed to be outside the judicial power of the United States. So what is the United States Supreme Court doing hearing this case? So that suggested to us that it was necessary to try and clean up some confusing areas of that, the 11th Amendment, and it caused us to embark on our paper. So I don't know if you guys have gotten an opportunity to read the paper. It's all on SSRN. If not, so I encourage you to look it up. But the basic point that we try to make is we try to draw a distinction between the common law immunity that states might enjoy under general common law and the very specific prohibition on federal courts under the 11th Amendment, that these two are different things. And once you start analyzing them as different things, you start understanding how they might function differently. So let's see how this works. First of all, the common law immunity. This was an immunity from compulsory process. So you could not hail a state into court and force them to show up. And it was derived from general and international law. If you look at some of the old sources like Nathan versus Virginia, they talk about this as one of the rules of the common law regarding sovereigns. You cannot hail another sovereign into court. Our claim is that that immunity survived Article III, notwithstanding Chisholm, which said that it had been abolished by the head of jurisdiction for suits between citizens of other states and sovereign states. Our claim is that no, in fact, the head of jurisdiction was there, but nonetheless, this personal jurisdiction immunity remained in force unless the state waived it. And in that way, it's like federal sovereign immunity. So there's Article III jurisdiction for cases where the United States is a party, but that doesn't mean that you can just go and sue the United States, because they have this same unwritten common law immunity from compulsory process. Madison in the ratification conventions also analogized it to rules about couverture or alienage. So for instance, a married woman couldn't sue, that would be absurd, or an alien enemy couldn't sue, but that doesn't mean that the Constitution sort of left them out of the citizen diversity or alien diversity clauses. It just meant that there were other rules other than the availability of subject matter jurisdiction that might come in to interrupt those suits. And likewise, the immunity from compulsory process was not a subject matter jurisdiction, it was a personal jurisdiction immunity, but it might prevent you from bringing that suit in federal court. Okay, add all of that to all of this, the new cases that the court has heard from the end of the 19th through 20th century. So some of the most famous sovereign immunity cases, we argue, are actually common law immunity cases, not 11th Amendment cases at all. So Hans versus Louisiana, that a citizen can't sue his own state, that's outside the terms of the 11th Amendment. There's no sort of penumbral 11th Amendment immunity that affects you here. It's just the common law rule that you can't force your own state into court. Likewise, Seminole Tribe. Does Congress have power to abrogate this immunity in federal court? That wasn't an 11th Amendment case. That was a common law immunity case on our reading. And there might be reasons why Congress is unable to abrogate it. I'll be happy to talk about more of those in the Q&A. Likewise, Alden versus Maine, can they abrogate in state court? Or Hyatt, can a state abridge another state's immunity? And would the other state have to recognize it? All of these are common law questions, not about the 11th Amendment. So what is about the 11th Amendment? Well, the 11th Amendment is pretty precise. It says the judicial power of the United States shall not be construed to extend any suit in law or equity commenced or prosecuted against one of the United States by citizens of another state or citizens or subjects of any foreign state. Our claim is that this amendment means precisely what it says. It is a cross-cutting bar on federal subject matter jurisdiction that is not waivable, that is not abrogable by Congress, and that applies in the cases that it describes and in no others. So how does that work? Well, let's start off line by line. Judicial power of the United States. That is a clear limit on the subject matter jurisdiction of federal courts. It is not about their personal jurisdiction like the common law immunity. As a result, it's non-waivable because, as everyone knows, you have jurisdiction. That made sense at the time because there were a number of pending cases where process had already been served on various states by private citizens under Chisholm, the Supreme Court decision that said that this was okay. And the the framers of the 11th Amendment wanted to kick those states out of court, or wanted to kick those cases out of court, rather. In the 1880s, the Supreme Court messed this up because there was a complicated case in which a state had intervened as a plaintiff. And they said, oh, yes, that's fine. The state can intervene as a plaintiff because this is just a personal privilege waivable at the state's pleasure. And from then on, the Supreme Court and everybody else started saying the 11th Amendment is waivable, even though the text of the 11th Amendment gives the states no ability to waive. It's just a mandatory rule about the federal judicial power. So our argument is all that stuff is wrong. The 11th Amendment is not waivable in a case that falls within its terms. Shall not be construed to extend. Well, what exactly shall not be construed to extend to various things? The answer is the judicial power. So we say this is a cross-cutting limit. It affects all of Article 3. The more common theory in the academy, which is known as the diversity theory, reads the amendment much more narrowly. It says that it only applies to state diversity jurisdiction. It's just a rule for how to construe the jurisdiction given in Article 3 for when a citizen sues a different state, and that it doesn't have any application to federal question cases or any other circumstance in the heads of jurisdiction. We think that's wrong. We think it's not as good a reading of the text, which for one thing is a cross-cutting limit. The term shall not be construed to extend were used back then, not just to resolve interpretive confusions, but just to carve out exceptions from statutes. So you have a general statute and they say, well, it shall not be construed to apply to more than five justices at the same time or something like that. That is the sort of change that doesn't have anything to do with interpreting the text. It's just carving out an exception. It also fits, our theory we think fits better with the drafting history. So Senator Gallatin, while this was being drafted, wanted to introduce an amendment to say that the 11th Amendment wouldn't apply in treaty cases. To us, that suggests that without his amendment, it would have applied in treaty cases, even though those are federal question cases. And also the early interpretation. So in a case called Osborne versus United States, a very famous federal question case, the Supreme Court said that it was okay to sue Ralph Osborne, treasurer of Ohio, without joining the state, because even though this was a federal question case, you couldn't join the state because that would violate the 11th Amendment. So it seems pretty clear that the Supreme Court, as of the 1820s, thought that federal question cases were included in the 11th Amendment because that was necessary to the holding in Osborne. So all of this suggests to us that shall not be construed means the whole thing shall not be construed, and you can't file federal question cases if you come from a different state than the state that you're suing. Why would they have done such a thing? Why did they care about preventing, you know, allowing in-state citizens to sue under federal questions but not out of state? It's not that they had some special reason for doing it. They just were, you know, making a broad brush stroke. I mean, they were cutting off a branch of jurisdiction, and they were cutting it off with a chainsaw rather than a scalpel. If you guys are familiar with the traditional Christmas movie Die Hard, you will remember a scene in which Alexander Goodenough cuts through a whole bunch of wires all at once with a chainsaw. That is the 11th Amendment. It is just cutting through Article 3. It's not being super careful there. They're just trying to eliminate all the potential sources they could think of for suits against states that they really, really did not want. Okay, moving on to any suit. What that means is that you cannot abrogate the 11th Amendment in Congress. Under current doctrine, it is okay for Congress to abrogate the 11th Amendment if they're doing it under the 14th Amendment. We find that a little bit strange. You would never say that the 14th Amendment allows you to abrogate the Fourth Amendment so you can have suspicionless searches inside people's houses for civil rights violations. It doesn't abrogate the Sixth Amendment, you can't take away jury trial, and doesn't abrogate the Eighth Amendment, so civil rights violators can't be tortured to death. No one would think that the 14th Amendment does any of that stuff. So why would it override another constitutional limit in the 11th Amendment governing the federal judicial power? More interestingly, the cases where the Supreme Court said this was okay were not 11th Amendment cases. They involved in-state citizens who, again, might have to face the common law immunity if they're trying to sue their own state, but maybe Congress has more ability to abrogate that under the 14th Amendment than it would under other things. We're not sure that's true, and I'm happy to say more in the Q&A, but at least that's plausible in a way that abrogating some other part of the Constitution is not. So maybe you can abrogate the common law immunity, not the 11th Amendment immunity. In law or equity, what's that doing there? Well, the only reason that they would possibly have put that in is to exempt out admiralty cases. Why would they do that? Admiralty cases were typically done in rem at the time. And so the fact that you might be dealing with property in which the state had a claim didn't necessarily mean that the state could invoke an immunity. So in admiralty cases, you can sometimes have an in personam admiralty case. And if you do, and if you're suing the state, or if you're trying to go after state property, that's just up to the common law rule. Courts mostly get this right, but not entirely. There's a little bit of slippage between sort of, is this a common law immunity? Is this an 11th Amendment immunity? And our point is just, let's be clear about it, in law or equity leaves admiralty out. Where does it make a difference? Well, the Supreme Court today allows admiralty jurisdiction in a lot more cases than it used to. You know, there was a joke that if you found a puddle, the Supreme Court would say that it could exercise admiralty jurisdiction over it. So, you know, if that is not the original scope of admiralty jurisdiction, then you probably can't sue states at all, even if they consent, even if Congress has tried to abrogate it, et cetera, using admiralty jurisdiction over a puddle. You've got to use the original admiralty jurisdiction, which might be limited to the high seas. Commenced or prosecuted. What was that language doing there? Well, that language applied not only to cases that were originally filed in a federal court, but also to cases that were prosecuted there. That means that it applies on appeal, even in the Supreme Court. So if you file your case in state court and the state is okay with that, and then you appeal up through the state system and then appeal to the Supreme Court, then it has to decide, is this within its appellate jurisdiction? Is it within the judicial power of the United States? According to Cohen's versus Virginia, we figure that out not based on who's appealing to the Supreme Court, but based on how the suit was originally filed. So if Virginia initiates a criminal prosecution in its own courts against the Cohens, that is not a suit commenced or prosecuted by the private citizen. That's a suit commenced or prosecuted by Virginia, by the prosecutors. And so it's outside the scope of the amendment. It can be appealed up to the Supreme Court. But somebody like Mr. Hyatt suing the state of California, that's not okay, and the Supreme Court can't hear it. There was a case called McKesson not too long ago in which the Supreme Court announced, yes, we can hear appeals from state courts, even if they were originally filed as a diverse plaintiff against the state, and that's because our jurisdiction was inherent in the constitutional plan. We agree with Justice Souter in dissent, who said that makes no sense. Indeed, the constitutional plan is whatever the Constitution says it is. And if the Constitution says no jurisdiction, then they can't have any jurisdiction here. And in Hollingsworth versus Virginia, which is a 1798 case decided weeks after the amendment's ratification was announced, the plaintiffs raised this exact hypo. They said, well, if there were a case filed in state courts with permission and then appealed up to the Supreme Court under federal question jurisdiction, of course the Supreme Court couldn't hear it. Nonetheless, the Supreme Court decides otherwise in McKesson. We think that a limit on the judicial power of the United States clearly affects the Supreme Court. It may be a very important court, but it doesn't have any power outside Article 3. And it is limited by the scope of the judicial power. It can't declare for itself what the constitutional plan has to be. Against one of the United States, who does the 11th Amendment protect? Well, we say it's states only. That means not counties or cities, not Native American tribes, not territories, the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, not compact clause entities that are created when multiple states get together. None of that is one of the United States to enjoy the 11th Amendment. They may get protection under the common law immunity. There are lots of cases about, especially with regard to Native American tribes, about the scope of their immunity, but it's just not an 11th Amendment question, and courts should stop mentioning the 11th Amendment when they talk about Puerto Rico or territories, et cetera. And who can't file under the 11th Amendment? Well, it says citizens of another state or citizens or subjects of any foreign state. That means it applies to suits by diverse plaintiffs only. That does not include suits by states, So New Hampshire versus Louisiana, where New Hampshire was basically sort of the assignee for collection of one of its citizens' bond suits. We would say that's not an 11th Amendment case, it's just a common law case. Likewise, foreign state, so Monaco versus Mississippi, not an 11th Amendment case in our view, but it is potentially a common law immunity case. Federal corporations or compact clause entities, like in Alabama versus North Carolina from 2010, whether those entities can sue states in federal court depends in part on how you think corporate citizenship works. I'd be very happy to talk about more about that in the Q&A. It used to be that corporations were treated as just agglomerations of individuals. Then the Supreme Court said, no, they're only a citizen of the state that created them. And so maybe a federal corporation is in some way stateless as a result of that. I'm not sure I buy that, but if you take current doctrine to hold that it sort of isn't a citizen of any state, well, then it's not on this list. And then it can sue states notwithstanding the 11th Amendment, though again, it still might have to face the common law immunity. So in sum, the 11th Amendment is widely misunderstood. And it's misunderstood because courts for a very long time have used the words 11th Amendment immunity to refer to any kind of sovereign immunity instead of a very specific kind of sovereign immunity, one that binds federal courts, their subject matter jurisdiction, and only in the cases that the amendment names. The 11th Amendment applies according to its terms. For everything else, there's the common law. So thank you guys very much. I will